otra academia académica de la Universidad de Hamburgo, en Alemania, en la maestría y el doctorado. Y como experiencia profesional, pues ha estado en la actualidad en Guanajuato. También estuvo en el área de astrofísica de la Universidad de Sussex en Inglaterra. Estuvo también en la Universidad Técnica de Berlín, en el Centro de Astrofísica. Como invitado también en el Instituto de Astronomía de Cambridge. Su experiencia docente pues está en Hamburgo, Braunschweig, la Freie Universität de Berlín, en Brighton y ahora en Guanajuato. Tiene además una preparación, él fue preparado para óptica, en óptica también. Tiene una preparación en óptica y como hobby ha construido algunos instrumentos astronómicos. Me decía él que construyó su propio heliógrafo, un heliógrafo construyó incluso el stop para detener la luz directa del sol. Entonces, muy buena experiencia en este tipo y nos va a platicar del telescopio Tigre que está en Guanajuato, el cual podría resultar en una colaboración con el Centro de Óptica para el Desarrollo de la Instrumentación. Bueno, entonces el doctor Peter Schröder y nos va a hablar del Tigre.
Muchas gracias por la introducción. Tengo que decir que el doctor Zacarías ya me ha mostrado algunos laboratorios, es muy impresionante. La idea fue que yo quizás llevo a ustedes una idea que se hace con óptica, en este caso óptica de astronomía. Normalmente se demuestran bonitos fotos de galaxias y todo eso, y alguien pregunta, ¿y para qué es bueno eso? ¿No? Pero hoy les voy a explicar que lo que estamos estudiando aquí, cuando hicimos el ojo de Guanajuato al sol, sí tiene relevancia para nuestra vida diaria. Y cómo está una liga entre sol y clima y todo esto, eso voy a explicar. También me dijeron que haya más puntos para el seminario si lo doy en inglés y los estudiantes pueden practicar su inglés. Y como también está una grabación, mi inglés siempre es comparable en inglés, entonces voy a cambiarme para esa práctica al inglés, pero los textos están en español. Okay. Right, so the telescope I want to present to you is a little bit too large to bring in my hand luggage. It has a 1.2 meter diameter main mirror here in this housing. The dome has 6 meters. And you find this instrumentation when you go up and beyond the Cristo Rey. Near the little community of La Luz. There we have an observatory which also has a 60 centimeter Cassegrain telescope for our postgrado students. Well, and Tigre, however, is not very user friendly for people who want to look at stars. It is completely robotic. It makes its own things easy. It has a computer that is giving it a list of stars which it selects from all the proposals that we have made. We are a consortium of 3 universities, Guanajuato, Hamburg and Liège. And once a year we compile a list of stars with requirements, how often we want to observe them, and which spectral region, and so on. And the computer, each night, gives the telescope a list of objects, and the telescope just opens the dome. There is an instrumentation to make sure it's good weather. When a cloud comes, the dome closes. And the telescope is connected via a fiber of 50 meters with a spectral card, which is here on a robust table in a stable temperature environment. Well, this was difficult because the sun burns onto this roof, so the room without temperature control goes up to 60 centigrades in the afternoon and it goes down to 0 centigrades in winter nights. So working out that within we are now within a degree or so of stable temperature, was very important. We have a high resolution spectrograph, so the stable temperature is necessary for the stability of the reference scale. So that's the setup, a telescope that was built in Germany and contributed to us by our Hamburg colleagues. And the question is, how would you observe the sun with such a telescope? Well, better not, because with a mirror of 1.20 meters, you would burn everything. So there's a little trick. And we are not solar astronomers. I am not a solar astronomer. I'm a stellar astronomer. But the sun is a star. Only the sun is very close. So you don't think it's a star, but it is actually a star. It's only because it's right by our doorstep. So we are using this telescope to study the sun as a star. And are these all advancing? Right. So this is the telescope. Here it was in Hamburg when it was tested, and it had a place where it was easier to photograph, because now we have a very small dome, and since nobody is supposed to be at the telescope when it works, there's no space to take a decent photo. So my best photos are still when it was shown to me many years ago in Hamburg. And Germans are not that small, but you get an idea of the real size of the telescope. Even though I have to admit, this colleague is not as tall as me. So the telescope, no, this is the 1.20 meters. This is not exactly a backyard amateur telescope. It's a little bit larger. And this construction weighs 15 tons. The heaviest single part is this fork with 8 tons, with that foot. And the precision of this telescope, and this is necessary to operate robotic, to find a star, put it on a fiber with 3 arcseconds in the sky of diameter. For that precision, you need a very accurate reading scale, which is here with encoders, and a Dequard scale with micro accuracy markings on it, and 30 centimeter diameter is in this box. So that enables the telescope to have an orientation in the sky with a resolution of several arc seconds. By comparison, the moon that you see in the sky has 2,000 arc seconds roughly. So we use this telescope to mainly observe stars. Now, how can you include the sun and compare the sun with stars? That is a big problem. So there is solar astronomy, and they have their specialized solar telescopes, and then they see a single sunspot, a single granulum, lot of individual features on the sun, and then they say the sun is very different from the stars because, well, look at all the fine structure, and we don't know how the sun looks like a star, because we get confused by all the detail that we see on the sun, and so it's very difficult to actually compare the sun with a star, because a telescope that sees the sun cannot see a star. A star is not so bright, and the telescope that sees a star gets burned by the intensity of the solar light. So that is a very, very simple trick, and I will introduce you to the man who invented that trick many years ago in a short moment. The trick is to just, for spectrography, spectroscopy, point the telescope to the moon. Now the moon is not a perfect mirror, and it also has some color, but for spectroscopy it doesn't matter, because the moon does not have any atmosphere. So the spectrum is not altered. A little bit perhaps the slope of the spectrum, but in a high resolution spectrum, you get exactly the solar spectrum for moonlight. And moonlight is cold. If you point on the part of the moon, you have the same brightness in your fiber as if you go to a medium-sized star of 4th or 5th magnitude. So to take a spectrum of the sun, or of the sun as a star, because the moon receives the total sunlight, and you don't see any structure. When you go to a solar astronomer, I have actually been to a gorgeous solar observatory on Tenerife in Isania. It's very impressive. And then they tell you, look, here's the downward motion. And now I go to the center of the granule, and here's the upward motion. And look, and here it's cooler, and there it's warmer. And you don't get any quantification of the sun as a whole, because it depends where you are on the sun. The moon sees the whole sunlight, and you see the sun as a star with the whole integration over the surface for free. And this is something that solar astronomers have big difficulties to achieve, and then they cannot observe the stars with the same instrument. Or simply point a telescope to the moon, get the moonlight, and there you are. So this is how we do this. And so we observe like regularly about 150 stars. 100 stars are similar to the sun, 50 stars are giant stars that are not well understood yet, and the sun whenever the moon is up. So we can then compare the sun with stars and say, oh, this is a bit odd, or this is quite normal. So that's the idea. Okay, so as you are used to astronomical optics and construction drawings, here is the optical layout. Sorry. So the main mirror with 1.20 meters here focuses the light on the secondary. It's a Hergé-Chrétien optics, but in a classical Nasmyth orientation. So the Nasmyth focus means that you have a plane third mirror that reflects the light into either side of the elevation axis. The idea is, at the moment we have only one spectrograph attached to one side, but soon we will get an infrared spectrograph from our Liège colleagues to serve from the other side. And by flipping this mirror, you can go from one instrument to the other within a matter of minutes. So that's the idea, and that's the advantage of the Nasmyth orientation of this optics. So here's the probe that you have seen with the encoder. And because here are about 10 tons that pressure on the base, and to actually turn the telescope, despite all that friction, you have to counteract that weight by pressure. So the oil that is in here is pressurized by about 100 atmospheres with a oil pump. And the oil is pushing the telescope up. Now, that sounds very simple, but it's obvious when you push too much, then well, the telescope will not flip out, but the oil will come out here. No? So we need a special sensor that regulates within a few hundredths of a millimeter whether the telescope is floating or whether it's going too high, so that the oil will not spill out. So we have a constant feedback mechanism. And already twice that sensor broke. So now we have two sensors in series, because when it breaks and the oil spills out, it's a big mess. We have a whole barrel of oil in the system. No, it's like 100 liters of oil. And so that is a messy bit. But thanks to that oil pressurizing system, the telescope is moved very smoothly with very small motors. Okay, so this is the housing that we put up in 2011. We had some money for the housing, and then 2012 we got money for the dome to finish it. So it always comes in slices in Mexico. You always build first dormitory and then extend by your house bit by bit, no? And so did we. While the telescope was under development in Hamburg and under testing. And so here is the home for the spectrograph. Here is the oil pump and auxiliary instrumentation, the electronics or the telescope and so on. And this is a huge base. So the idea is to put the telescope a little bit above ground, like 4 meters above ground, so that all the dust and the turbulence that comes from the ground is beneath the telescope. That actually helps a lot. And the base is filled with sand and stands on a bed of gravel. So vibrations of different frequencies, the low frequency vibrations are damped in the gravel, high frequency is damped by the sand in the base. They are all peeled out. And so even though it looks a little bit strange that the telescope sits up here, it's standing better than a rock. It's not standing as a rock, it's standing better than a rock because the rock has no bending. So that has worked out very well, that construction. And there was in March 2013, that was the great day when, well, first it took 3 months to get the telescope through customs. It was a big mess. It was, I think, the fault of the importer company that cheated us. But anyway, when it finally arrived on my birthday in February in the observatory, then a few weeks later we had the Hamburg people there who use the telescope inside out. This guy is the Hamburg Mechanics Workshop director, and these are colleagues, astronomers from Hamburg. So they all came over, and then we ordered the biggest crane that we could get in the state of Guanajuato. Because I learned a lot in organizing this, like, okay, this is only 8 tons, but because it has to be driven up with a long lever to set into the dome from above. So this dome does not rotate. This is one thing less that can go wrong at night. It only opens and closes, no? So, and the advantage is also you open it and then you put the telescope in from above. But with that long lever, so nominally the crane had to have capacity of 90 tons. So it was the biggest crane that you could get in Guanajuato. So that was the interesting bit, to get this right on the pillar. And then in a small construction that we ordered master tailored from the same company that has the cranes. We had then the arrangement to set the mirror, which weighs about half a ton, into its cell, and together this weighs 2 tons. So that cell has a lot of contact points to distribute the weight, and they are counterbalanced. So the mirror kind of swims on the mechanical support structure. And this was one of the things that needed to be repaired. So it was, here the same guy, Arnes Lewis from the Hamburg Workshop, that said, hey, come, send me the mirror cell back and I do the job for you, that it works well, so that you do not get any distortions. I repair the cell, I put some extra contact points to make it better supported than before. And then we can ship the mirror anyway and aluminize it in Hamburg. Because that was a problem. 1.20 meters, you guys here have 60 centimeters or 80. And 1.20 meters with a protection layer over the aluminium, nobody has it in Mexico. So we had only the choice to either ship it to America, to North America, or to Hamburg. So, so these parts, right now, are still in Tamaulipas, coming back by ship from Hamburg, and customs is scratching head over what we have been sending. So, so here you can see it from the other observatory building that we have, how it looks like when the dome opens or closes. The telescope, you are actually thinking, oops, does it close without touching the telescope? there's only like 6 centimeter tolerance here. But it worked out. It was a bit nerve-wracking at the moment and when we put it in and oops, does it close? Yeah. But it all worked out well in the end. Nobody mismeasured anything. Okay. Now the spectrograph. The spectrograph is of most interest to us astrophysicists because it's producing the data, it's characterizing the atmosphere of the star and its state. That is not on the telescope because, well, with a small spectrograph it doesn't matter, but with a high resolution spectrograph, A, the spectrograph is pretty large and it's not good for the telescope to have so much weight to carry it around. But then also the spectrograph, when you incline it, it starts to bend. And then the wavelength scale moves, and that's not good. So, and then of course the night temperature drops, the spectrograph gets colder, metal shrinks, again the wavelength scale changes. So what we do is have only the optical fiber coming out from the focus, and this is a camera that looks at the field of view and makes sure that via a little glass plate with 10% of the light, the camera is putting the star on the pixel, which represents the position of the fiber. The computer knows that position. This has to be, by humans, has to be calibrated once, and then the computer knows I have to go to XY 537-283. Boyon, the star is on the fiber, and then from there on it's been guiding. So that arrangement is made with this little field camera. And the whole spectrograph is in the annex. I forgot to bring a photo of the spectrograph actually, but I have, a construction design. So it's about 1 meter by 70 centimeter. The spectrograph sits on a table that weighs another half a ton. And it's an Echelle spectrograph. I don't know how common knowledge of Echelle spectrograph is. Echelle is a grating that is used in very high orders. We use orders between 50 and 75. So the light enters here. The light enters from the telescope from here, through that entrance, and goes on what looks like a mirror, but it's actually a grating. And light enters like this and comes back like this, because the Echelle is placed so to reflect into the highest orders. So it's really crazy. The light goes in and it doesn't go out here, it goes straight back, but in high orders. And that brings a high resolution. But then all the orders overlap, so you need a cross disperser. And that is the way of working with an Echelle spectrograph. Now, this one has a special trick. It was developed in Heidelberg and for a while was used in Prague when my Hamburg colleague Jürgen Schmidt, who developed all the instrumentation in Hamburg, found it in Prague because the CCD cameras broke down. And he said, you're not really using this, right? Could I have it? Could I bring it back to Germany? I have an idea what to use it, to do with it. So he bought new CCD cameras, and so the spectrograph that went from Heidelberg to Prague, came back to Hamburg, and now is in Bonaparte. And the trick here is that to get a large coverage of the whole spectral range with large resolution, there is a dichroatic beam splitter. So the red light goes to that camera, and the blue light goes to that camera. So one Echelle makes two Echelle. There's one Echelle grating, which is the expensive bit, and after the dichroatic beam splitter, we have two different cross dispersers, one for the blue and one for the red, somewhere here. So these cross dispersers are optimized. When you have one cross disperser for the whole spectral range, you get your orders too compact in the blue and you are wasting space in the red. And in this way you can optimize each channel. And we have only a loss of about 50 ohmstoms in the near the sodium line, around 550 nanometer. And but we get with the two cameras, we get the near infrared from 8,800 ohmstoms to the near ultraviolet, 3,650 ohmstoms in one shot simultaneously, which is very good because sometimes most of our observations, as you will see, are focusing on one line in the ultraviolet. But then later somebody is interested to see, oh, what did those lines in the infrared do at the same time? So you go to the archive and there the whole information is. Okay, so you can do of course lots of things with such a spectrograph. You take the spectrum of a star. We have a guy who has models of stellar atmospheres that are made consistent with a model spectrum. And then we can see, oh, that one matches. So this temperature, back gravity, and until we get the characteristics of the star on that chemical composition. But that has almost been done for all bright stars already. Well, we want to do it a little bit better, but that's a little bit too boring for us to run a telescope and take spectra of stars all over. We are after the dynamical processes in stars. And there are a lot of things that are not well understood. And when you look at the sun, the obvious thing that is not well understood is what we call solar activity. It's the consequence of the presence of dynamic magnetic fields. So magnetic fields are present here and here. You can see what is well known, the sunspots. Sunspots are regions where magnetic field lines break through the photosphere in loops. Where they break through the photosphere, they turn down the convection, so hot matter cannot come up to the surface as much as in the normal surface. So these spots are dark. But right above them, in this layer between photosphere and chromosphere, this magnetic field is producing an extra heating. And so in this areas that you see only ultraviolet, in these areas magnetic field is actually producing more light, in particular ultraviolet light. So this is called faculas. And normally you have to send a satellite into space to see them. But we can see them in a special emission in the two lines of calcium 2 that are in the near ultraviolet that we get from ground. And when you make a photo in that line, you get the same structures. So we are after these emissions in specific lines. And the amount, the coverage of the sun with this facula is a good measure of the activity. And the good thing is, you get the same to see for other stars. You do not resolve other stars like this, but you get the emission in the spectra of other stars. So you can compare the sun with other stars by those spectra. So, and such a spectrum looks like this, so the line is huge with our resolution. The whole line goes all over this wall here. And then in the very center, there's a tiny emission. And that tiny emission is produced in those areas of the facula. And if you measure that emission, you have a measure of the activity of the sun or the star. And when you do this with the same telescope, the sun suddenly can compare directly with stars. So I should tell you a little bit about, well, say, photosphere, chromosphere. I should explain that a little bit. The photosphere is where we get the white light from that we perceive with our eyes. So that's why it's called photosphere. it looks like a surface, because when you look at the sun, hopefully with a good filter or in projection, you will look at the sun with a telescope, your eyes are burned. So when you look at the sun with a safe instrumentation, its limb looks very sharp. But that's an illusion. If you could resolve better, you would see that actually what looks like a surface is not a surface. It's a region of about 200 kilometer depth that that becomes opaque at its bottom. And that's where the last photon scattering takes place before the photon is sent out. So that's the layers where the photons come to us freely. Below, the sun is opaque, and the photons are scattered millions of times in the way up. And above, the layers are too thin, so in white light you don't see anything. And the transition is only 200 kilometers. We resolve like 700 kilometers with one arc second. So you would have to resolve fractions of an arc second to see that the sun is not really sharp here. And in the photosphere, the magnetic activity, the sort of loops that come out of the sun, produce these dark sunspots. They have already been observed by Chinese people, and so there are historic recordings of sunspots when the sun sets in the haze. So we get some idea about the presence or absence of solar activity even over the centuries back to the Chinese recordings. And above this is what we call the chromosphere. The chromosphere is a layer of about 2,000 kilometer thickness, and it leads to the lower corona. And the chromosphere, well, what comes out of the chromosphere are these called prominences. They look like clouds in the corona. It's condensed matter. The chromosphere, well, the photosphere is like 5,700 Kelvin. The chromosphere is about 8,000 to 10,000 Kelvin. And then the corona above it is a lot hotter, up to 1,000,000 Kelvin. So 10,000 Kelvin, hydrogen is still mainly neutral, and it's condensing along field lines and forming these prominences. And the chromosphere we can only see in very strong lines, like hydrogen alpha, because only in very strong lines you can see those thin layers. In white light, you look straight through it. This is why in white light you only see the photosphere. And the chromosphere also shows these hot regions, these macula. And above it is the corona. You will get to see, well, some of you may have seen the corona here in Guanajuato in 1992. I was actually in Baja California at that time, and I didn't even know that Guanajuato existed. It was cloudy,
yeah.
And some people have told me that they had seen it, but maybe they were cheating me.
Maybe
it
was a very short time, something like 10 minutes that the clouds opened and were able to see the corona.
So we were lucky, For that matter, I avoided the mountains. I didn't know about Guanajuato at the time. I went to Baja California. And I had a beautiful experience on the beach. It's the first time I came to Mexico, but it was all in the hands of the gringos there. This one is one of my own photos from Turkey, 2006. That is another beautiful eclipse. The next one here will be in the area of Mazatlan in 2024, so relatively soon that we have. Get your own view of the solar corona. So that gas is so thin that you have to put the moon in front of the sun to actually see it, no? So be in the shade of the shadow of the moon. And the corona reflects the magnetic structures here. Over magnetic arcs you form these extensions, no? And schemas here. Here is open magnetic field structure, here is closed magnetic field structure. So in the corona, the magnetic field is so dominant that the structure reflects the structure of the magnetic field. In the photosphere, the magnetic field can only modulate the efficiency of the convection. This is why you get the sunspots. But the gas is so dense in the photosphere that it's pushing the magnetic field around. So the activity, the magnetic effects on the star, on the sun, therefore depend a lot. They depend on which layer you're looking at. Sunspots in the photosphere, the facula between photosphere and chromosphere, and also the brightness of the corona and the structure in the corona. So now for stars, we can actually see how bright is the corona when we look at stars with X-ray satellites. Since the 1990s, it's possible to see coronal activity in stars that are not too far away via the X-ray emission. So, like the solar corona also produces X-rays, but fortunately we are protected by our atmosphere. And the chromospheric response, the facula, we can see via that emission in the calcium ion that you have seen. And the sunspots, that's difficult photometrically to measure with stars. So for stars, we can compare stars with the sun only by X-ray emission from the corona, or by the emission in the calcium ion from the chromosphere. And in that way, we can compare the sun directly with stars. So that's the advantage. And an X-ray satellite is a lot more expensive than our telescope in Guanajuato, I can tell you that. Okay. So a little bit about the activity of the sun, at least. So by sunspot counts, we have the longest records, and we can see two things. That usually there is activity goes up and down in cycles of about 11 years, but they are semi-regular, these cycles. It's like a semi-regular periodicity. And there are long-term variations that seem to have a typical time scale of 100 years. So like around 1900 and around 1800 to 1820, especially in this period, there were solar activity cycles that were very low. While in the second half of the 20th century, we had very high cycles. Those three cycles here were comparatively strong. So we used to refer to these cycles as normal, but maybe they were abnormally strong. So this is a matter of perspective. Had we been grown up in these years, we would say, oh, what a strong solar activity now. And there was a period I'm coming to talk about in a moment, the Maunder minimum, that was between 1645 and 1715. And that was supposed to be very cold. And then there was a lot of discussion. Was it really so cold? Maybe it was all because nobody really measures the temperature. Well, but you know Guanajuato is a center, no? Have you seen the houses there? They have half a meter thick walls. Why do you build half a meter thick walls? I mean, because it was so cold in Guanajuato in those days, because they are all built in the Maunder minimum time. So there is something real about this. And I will show you that link with solar activity, low solar activity, and cold winters at the end, so that you get an idea why are we doing this. Normally, galaxies, stars so far away, very interesting, but has no consequences for us, but the sun has. And here lies, I think, some ambition of our work, that we can actually do something that has a positive impact for us. We can perhaps predict long-term changes in solar activity, which are one of many climate factors. So that's the idea here. And yeah, but first of all, solar activity cycles have changes for the star that are very profound. When you look at the coronal images of the sun, in a maximum, they are very different from a minimum. And so a corona in a stellar minimum is almost black. you don't even detect the X-ray emission if the star is at 20, 30 light years distance. But in the maximum, it's very strong. And so the solar corona looks very different over a cycle. So these 11-year activity cycles are very pronounced, but they are not always of the same strength. So when you have high activity, you get eruptions in the sun, and plasma clouds pass the Earth. They are causing auroras. Here in Mexico, they are very rare. But when you go to Alaska, Canada, or Scandinavia in Europe, you frequently see these beautiful lights that are electrons bursting into our upper atmosphere. And these are very dynamic. So also by aurora countings, we have historic ideas about when was high and when was low activity. Now, here are the three large cycles of the 1980s, 1990s, and the early 2000s. Okay, so these are sunspot counts. These are sunspot counts. This is the coronal radio flux. And they go very well together, no? They look almost identical. And here's the present cycle. Oops. Well, there was already the cycle in the 1970s, which was lower. But this one is also a lot lower. It's like half of the cycles before. So when you look at the regular activity indicators, corona and sunspots, we already see that the present cycle, and we are now here. The cycle is over. We are now going into the next minimum. The present cycle is only half as strong as before. And the last minimum was quite pronounced, longer than normal. And there was less flux coming from the sun. And so a lot of things were different already in the last minimum. So this is why we got interested. And also when you look at sunspots, everything was better in the old days, right? The beer tasted better, the food tasted better, the sunspots were larger. This is photos I took 10 minutes. Okay, this is a photo I took as a student in the 1980s, and with my own 4-inch 10-centimeter telescope. Now, these are really good star sunspots, and today the sunspots are also small. So this actually reflects that the magnetic field strength is smaller. There is a real physical effect. It's not a romantic perception of, oh, when I was young, everything was better. Okay, so, when you look at it, so we are actually due for another period of relatively small cycles here. No, the present cycle is here. And it fits this long-term trend. And the warmer minimum was probably extended such period that lasted not for 3 cycles but for 7 cycles. And that warmer minimum, that is really interesting what happened. Like, I don't know whether you know London and the River Thames. Well, I've been there several times. And, never ever in my 10 years I lived in England, a whole solar cycle, has the Thames frozen over. But in 1677, the Thames froze over. And so did all other major rivers in Northern Europe. They normally never freeze, like the Elbe in Hamburg and others. So something was strange. And climatologists say, yes, but the global temperatures were not changing that much. So that was just a freak event. Okay, so the effect is very subtle, but it's directly related to what we observe in the emission in the calcium line. That emission comes from the same regions that are producing this ultraviolet radiation. And this ultraviolet radiation is heating, or not heating when it's absent, the stratosphere of Earth. And the stratosphere houses the jet stream that oscillates and brings low and high pressure areas across the northern continents. So there is a direct link between ultraviolet light produced in the same regions and by the same mechanism as the emission that we observe, and the jet stream that is in the bottom of the stratosphere and making movements, sometimes bringing low pressure areas when it comes down from the north, and sometimes bringing high pressure areas when it's going up. So all we need to do is to measure exactly the emission in the calcium line. And here the question is, how do you do this? With respect to what? So there is a method that was invented by the same guy, Alden Wilson, who had this glorious idea to observe the sun via moonlight to measure the emission. So this is the emission, and then relative to the continuum of this spectrum of the same star, so that opacity effects of the transparency effects of the atmosphere cancel out, and then to calibrate it by using a set of standard stars by which you determine this constant. And that was the guy, Alden Wilson. I actually met him once, but I had no idea. I was so young, I had no idea what he was working on. And today I have lots of questions for him, but he died in 94, so now it's too late. But he did beautiful work with a group of 12 people, and they were, actually they had no robotic telescope. That's the idea of a robotic telescope. This is, you can be lazy, you can sleep at night, and you can write papers, and the telescope does this work. They were actually working, 12 people, on the clock, to make those observations by hand. And among about 100 stars they monitored, they also looked at the sun via moonlight, and they found in his notation, this S index, that the sun was basically varying between the red and the blue line, while the red line is the average of the minimum years and the blue line of the maximum years. And they gave us a list of calibration stars. So it doesn't matter that we use a different telescope, that we don't need calibration lamps. Calibration lamps is a big problem for satellites, and also the electronics. Everything changes when it ages. We use calibration stars, the same of all in here. So now we do this work. We did it now the last few years. And oops, so it looks like, okay, so here's the minimum, here's the maximum. What's different? That's the average minimum of the three cycles before, that's the average maximum of the three cycles before. So something is completely out of line here, completely. And so there was this big discussion. Why would the change of solar activity make a climate impact? The climatologists always say, okay, you tell me your present cycle is half the normal strength. So what? We have such a variation every 10 years, we cannot even see a single cycle in the climate. Come other people, an English group around Adam Stife of the London Met Office, and say, yes, but look, this is solar activity records for the last 400 years, and whenever it was lower than normal or average, there were, statistically speaking, more cold winters. It's not a very strong correlation, but there is a correlation. And when you have high solar activity, then you have few colder winters, no? Again, there's a lot of debate. Ah, this is only statistically speaking, and who knows? Yeah. Anyway, so what however, can resolve this discussion is the following. So we could have an impact via the ultraviolet light that is not having a strong signature in the average temperature of the world, but on a local effect. The ultraviolet light heats the stratosphere and makes the jet stream go fast and relatively straight. But when the ultraviolet light becomes less, an inactive sun, you have a slower jet stream, and when the jet stream is very slow, it can make big excursions. And these excursions can, because the current goes like this, can bring weather from a very different climate zone to your place. And that can cause extremely cold winters or extremely dry or extremely wet summers. So that can cause more freak weather than normal, simply because the jet stream is playing lottery with us. And here is a typical situation. Somewhere underneath here is Mexico, and so you can have such an extension, and then you get all the those people here get all the hot warm air, and those get all the cold air, and those people, when this is stationary, they get the rain for 2 months and they get the heat for 2 months. So depending where you are, you have an extreme summer either way. And when the activity of the sun is high, the jet stream blows regularly, and you have 1 week good weather, 1 week bad weather, but not 2 months. So this kind of extreme oscillations of the jet stream seem to be able to explain the extreme winters that we experience in the warmer minimum, and apparently also here in Guanajuato. So it is the low solar activity that actually causes freak climate variations, not in the global temperatures, but locally in the northern continents of America and Europe. The low solar activity that happens every 100 years or so, that it's lower than normal, and we are entering such a period. So we have now a big chance to study these historic consequences. And even the extinction of the Maya could be related to, in that case, high solar activity. Subtle climate changes are apparently related to solar variation of activity. And of course, there is a big effect of the human CO2, that overall the temperatures are rising. That's the human CO2. But you remember, Obama came to power and said, we have to do something against the CO2. And then suddenly in New York, in Washington, fell 0.5 meter of snow. And then we said, Obama is crazy, look. Climate change? No. Well, Obama was just unlucky. Those were minimum years. That was a pronounced minimum that, in 2008-09. And that was the sun. And so we have two things. We have the global warming, yes. But on top of that, we have the effects of a very low activity sun that can cause freak winters, for instance, or droughts. We need to double the reservoir of the presas in Mexico to come up for having one summer without rain and one summer with double the rain. So these are the effects we are getting, and they cannot be discussed in terms of more or less increase of temperature or warming. No, they are much more subtle. And all this kind of study of climate effects and solar activity only starts just now. So that would be my assumption in English. So I hope I am more or less in time now.
¿Alguna pregunta?
Español sí está bien. Ya me puedo convertir en español.
I have a question. You don't have any other instruments besides the spectrometer for the instrument?
Yeah, at the moment the Liège people are developing an infrared spectrograph. So we can, in near time, take the same star in the infrared as well. What we would like to do is having a module that actually measures the polarization. And then we could measure the magnetic field strength directly. So, the, of course, averaged over the star, but this is one thing we still want to build. And we could also think of a low resolution spectrograph, but well, the large telescopes have low resolution spectrographs for extra galactic objects that are fainter, because then you have to concentrate the light, you have to compromise. So it's we are so good because we are doing something that nobody else does with such a small telescope. So we are focusing on the bright stars with high resolution one. So I think the next new step would be spectral polarimeter would be interesting.
And do you have any plans for a solar telescope? More solar telescope?
No. Well, it would be nice to have, but it's difficult to justify because there are no solar telescopes around in the world. No? I personally have an H-alpha filter. I can show you the chromosphere of the sun with my own telescope. Otherwise, that is always very well documented by the Solar Dynamics Observatory satellite. You can see it online. Sort of within every 30 minutes, it's a new picture of the sun in all spectral wavelengths. So having that is good for teaching, but you cannot scientifically justify it. But we might get our own measure of the 10.7 centimeter coronal radio flux when my radio astronomy colleagues get that finished. We have radio antennas as well.
¿Una pregunta? ¿Alguna pregunta? ¿Una pregunta? Okay.
El sitio, ¿cómo es? ¿Cómo encuentro la luz para astronomía en general? ¿Se necesita en este en particular para solar la estabilidad atmosférica? ¿La luz?
El malo es la luz, se incrementa, ¿no? La luz reflejada por el cielo. El cielo ya es muy sucio, a decir, porque aquí crece mucho la civilización. Y así no es, ya no es tan bueno para tomar fotografías de galaxias, por ejemplo. Pero si tú tomas nada más que 3 segundos de arco de cielo con la fibra y tienes ahí una estrella brillante, para que puedas usar esa gran resolución espectral, el cielo ya no se ve. Entonces, de hecho, el telescopio Tike, yo siempre he dicho esto, podría estar en mi jardín, ¿no? O en el centro de Guanajuato, o aquí en su campus. No importa por la espectroscopía de alta resolución. Y cuando tuvimos problemas con la mina, ahí dije que, ah, ¿por qué no lo pusimos en mi jardín? Pero las otras partes de la astronomía, los objetos más profundos, sí están afectados en la luz, ¿no? Pero ahí nos hemos especializado en una manera en que no estamos afectados, pero tenemos toda la ventaja de tener todo en un rancho de 25 minutos en coche, ¿no?
¿Preguntas? ¿Una pregunta tiene usted?
¿Utilizan algún sistema de enfriamiento extra para el mismo?
¿Un sistema de qué?
De enfriamiento.
Ah, para los CCDs, sí. Sí, los CCDs están con elementos de Peltier electrónicamente respirado a menos 40 centígrados, más o menos. El problema aquí es evitar la condensación de agua, ¿no? Eso, entonces, hay que isolar bien la ventana y el CCD por un vacuo y esas cosas son complicadas. Ahí son los límites. Si se pueda resfriar aún más con hidrógeno líquido, si lo tuviéramos, pero aún si lo tuviéramos, tuvimos esos problemas con la condensación.
¿Una pregunta más?
Sí, ¿es posible hacer alguna visita, que organizan visitas para estudiar o para público?
Sí, claro,
para poder conocer la situación.
Hoy mismo tengo una visita de estudiantes de ITC y me pueden contactar y con mucho gusto. Como no es tan portable que puedo poner en la mesa aquí, ustedes nos visitan y visitan todo el sitio, ¿no? Claro.
Muy bien. Pues vamos a agradecer al doctor Klaus.